you are also some kind of testing participants, okay? Because in case we will continue doing this, we would like to see how is the response and what do you feel is missing from this workshop and so on. So tomorrow I will try to give you a kind of feedback questionnaire. Please be you know, as direct as possible, at least concerning the material, okay? I know that you all find the workshop super duper, that's for sure, but at least comment on the material, okay? So that we know that this was not in the workshop and it should be in, or that was too much and so on, okay? So first of all, I don't know everybody of you personally because I was not in the, from the first day, okay? So I'm just guessing who you are. And therefore, maybe during the coffee break, we can get acquainted better. Fine. So yesterday, during the visit in Legnaro on Friday, I asked a couple of colleagues among you, what would you like to hear under nuclear reactions, low energy nuclear reactions? And I have to admit I didn't receive well-defined answers. So yesterday I tried to put a couple of things together, maybe in some arbitrary order, but I hope you will find it not necessarily interesting, but it will trigger some work from your side when you leave or during some phase of your work. So we would like to talk about low energy nuclear reactions, okay? The first question I have to you, because this will be an interactive presentation, what do you understand under low energy? What is your picture of low energy? How you define low energy? You said a few kV. What does it mean, a few kV? Up to? Well, that's not low energy. This is chaos. It's, you know, below, it's in the Hades, so to say. This is too low. You cover half of your of the region. Low energy means what? Low velocity. So what is a low energy, low velocity at the same time? What do you think is the maximum velocity you can accept? The speed of light is the maximum. It's not low energy. It's you know, the ultimate energy. So during, is everybody is physicist? You are all physicists here, I hope so, or not?
Yes, sir.
It won't be bad not to be, but I'm just asking. So when do you start doing relativistic corrections?
Square root of 2, C.
Square root of 2, C. Then you start doing relativistic. What is this energy, this velocity? Square root of 2, this means?
It's 0.14 C.
0.14 C.
Yeah, that is less than 400,000 kilometers.
Okay, maybe, but I'm just... I'm discussing this because you have to think that way. So in nuclear physics, we are usually say that low energy nuclear reactions are those phenomena where the velocity of the, let's say, of your moving particle is between 0.01 and 0.1 C. Okay, which is, I mean, the higher limit is something like 3 × 10⁹ meters per square. Okay? Meters per second, sorry, per square. Anyway, good. So just for the discussion. It's also a matter of taste what is low energy, okay? I mean, in nature, we have high energy physicists. It's the whole community that works, for example, at CERN, okay? They are got used to work with light speeds, or portions of light speed, okay? Significant. In nuclear physics, apart from some phenomena that happened at the so-called GV region, the rest is in general low energy. But for us, low energy, okay, let's think of, let's say, up to 20 MeV. Okay? So that's 20 MeV per nucleon, 20 MeV protons. Okay? It's low energy, believe me. Okay, now let's continue and let's discuss a bit what is a nuclear reaction. You will not find any or very few formulas in this talk, okay? And most of the quantities that we will be discuss will be a qualitative discussion. I'm not saying anything about neutrons, protons, or whatever, okay? To have as the presentation as general as possible. So a nuclear reaction is the process in which two particles collide to produce one or more particles that are different from those that began the process. Okay? So a nuclear reaction must cause a transformation of at least one particle to another. So which particles can we consider? It's a nuclear reaction. So we talk about nuclear particles. Okay? It can be also nucleus. Can it be gamma? One of the particles. Of course can be.
Yes.
Okay? Can be an electron, surely. Okay? And what is nuclear scattering? Nuclear scattering is the process where a particle interacts with another particle and then they separate without changing their nature of any nuclide. The nature, or not there, the nature of any nuclide. So nuclear and particles we know now. What do we mean with nature? Nature means what? Energy. Okay. Internal structure. Quantum numbers. And when we talk about nuclear reactions, we have some conservation laws. What could be these conservation laws? Energy. Linear momentum. Okay. What else?
Mass.
And charge. Okay? Fine. There are also some other conservation laws, but sometimes they are a bit tricky to deal with. Okay? So, nature we talk. Let's go now to the question why we are using nuclear reactions. Okay, we are using nuclear reactions to study nuclear properties in general. Okay, even applications are correlated with properties. I'm just giving here a list of reactions, let's say the nomenclature of the reactions. Coulomb excitation, okay, based on electromagnetic repulsion. Transfer and knockout reactions. We will go through them, but I'm just using the names here so that you will start getting acquainted with that. Reactions in the resonance region to study resonances and spins, parities, compound nucleus reactions, heavy ion reactions, okay? Fission and deep inelastic scattering, photonuclear reactions and nuclear resonance fluorescence, giant eyeball resonance, pygmy excitations, inelastic scattering to low-lying states to extract spins. We don't want to discuss all this in this foil, but I'm just, this is to show how wide the field of nuclear reactions is and how many physical phenomena are hidden behind it, and of course, how many models, okay? Now, we study the reactions themselves, okay, to understand how ions interact with nuclear matter and how nuclear species are produced. This is helpful for what? To understand surface and bulk analysis of materials, to perform bulk analysis and surface analysis of materials, to understand radiation transport in materials, okay? To produce radioisotopes, to work for nuclear reactors, to understand erosion of structural material in fusion. And of course, there is a big application of nuclear astrophysics to understand how species are synthesized in the cosmos, okay? Fine. Now, let's start with some very basic stuff, okay? I hope you are all acquainted, that will be that with you, okay? But let's take it from the beginning. Nuclear reactions and Q values. What is a nuclear reaction? Is A and A can give B plus B, or can give more, okay? On purpose, C is not used here. Fine, so we have, this is the entry channel, the entrance channel, and these are the various exit channels. This is the general way to describe a nuclear reaction. So we use reactants, exit channel one, exit channel two. Now, let's forget more than two here, okay, exit channels. And this we can write like this. So this is the target nucleus, the projectile, the ejectile, and the residual nucleus, okay? Usually, when we write a reaction like this, we measure that thing, not this one, okay? We can measure both, but then we talk about coincidences, usually. So in any nuclear reaction, if we want to use the nuclear reaction, in most of the cases we are detecting one of the products, usually the lighter one. Question, if you have the chance to make an analysis using a reaction that gives you a neutron, a beta particle, or a gamma, a photon, what would you be happy to use?
Gamma.
Gamma. Why? Think a bit. Why? Why a gamma? Because gammas usually have what? Well-defined energies. Neutrons have also well-defined energy depending on the reaction. Okay?
But it's not intrinsic to the particle.
And beta particles, we avoid them. Why? Because they have?
Continuous.
Usually they are in a continuous spectrum. Okay? So the amount of information you get from such an analysis is strongly related to the well-defined properties of the product that you are using for. Okay, now what are Q value? What is the Q value? Everybody knows what is the Q value?
It's
energy. But you know how, okay, sorry, but I have to say it. So a Q value is the masses before the reaction minus the masses after. Which masses? In energy units, okay? So, Ma plus M alpha minus MB minus MB minus MB, capital minus MB, okay? Energy units. We will see what this is. And of course, we all know Q value bigger than zero, exothermic reaction or exoergic. Negative endothermic, endoergic. And Q value equals zero, this is elastic scattering. So, question. Which category of reactions with Q, depending on the Q value, which Q value reactions, I mean, what reactions are most important in nucleosynthesis in cosmos, in the sun? Why?
Because they release energy.
Because they happen. Okay? You don't need to go to sun to put energy to start burning. Okay? Fine. Binding energy, nuclear atomic masses, and mass excess. What we know that the sum of the masses of nucleons is more, is bigger than the total nuclear mass. Okay? We see it here. Whoop. The mass of a nucleus, you could write it as the mass of protons times Z and so on. And there is here something that is correcting the whole story, this term, okay? And because of the Einstein formula, E equals mc squared, you write it like this, and this is the nuclear binding energy, okay? So if you look here, in this plot, mass number versus negative of binding energy per nucleon, you see this well-known plot, okay? What do we find immediately? What is the attractive point here? Is that around iron, you have the biggest binding energy, okay? Here you have lower, the trend, and here again lower. But apart from this region where we have to, where we say we have the stable stability or so, and see. From that side, you can come to this region by fission, whereas you can come here from that side by fusion, okay? This is because in the, on the left side, it's you know, it's, you need to fuse particles to become stable, whereas in the other side, you have to make fission so that nature will be stabilized. Okay. Now, if we make a calculation for the atomic mass, the mass of the atom, we have this relation that says that the mass of the atom is the mass of the nucleus plus the mass of the electrons minus the binding energy of the electron. Okay? And now because in the nuclear reactions the total charge is conserved, we can write M atom approximately equal with mass of nucleus. Is it boring for you? You sure? Okay. Why is that so? Why can we use this? Why can we write such a thing? Because when we write the reaction, A plus A capital, okay, the electrons are in both sides. What is the small difference? That the binding energy of the electrons in A capital may be a bit different from the binding energy in B capital. But the difference is so small that is negligible, okay? So once we do this, we have the atomic mass excess, okay? And the atomic mass excess is simply there, is the difference atom minus A times the atomic mass unit, the AMU, so to say, okay? Now, once we have this, the reaction A capital B capital has a Q value that is given by this simple relation. Okay, atomic mass excess. Clear? Clear. Fine. Here we have the case of the famous reaction of Rutherford. The first, okay, nuclear reaction in the lab. What is the Q value here? For that, we need the atomic mass table, okay? The last one is published in 2017, and it's the atomic mass evaluation. It's a very famous paper. You can download it, okay? It's public, it's not, is how it's called, free access. Okay, and here you see that you have for the proton, the mass excess, the proton is here, okay? You have for the oxygen, 17 is here, and so on and so on. So you just simply take this table and you calculate the Q value, okay? And if you do this exercise, the Q value is 1191 something keV. Okay. Experimentalists in nuclear physics do something very simple. What do? They have a scattering chamber, okay? They have a target, they have a beam, they shoot the beam on the target, and they produce particles. This can be gamma also. The B is simply, okay, the light product. And a detector that gives you a signal, and you go to the data acquisition, and here at the Faraday cup, you just take the, you integrate the current. Why you integrate the current? Where is this necessary? No. This is the next step. Okay. Why you need the current integrator? What gives you the charge? What gives you the charge? You integrate what? Current. When you integrate the current, what do you get?
Charge.
Where is this charge coming from? From your beam. Which means this setup is for charged particle reactions. Once you have your charge, what can you calculate? The number of particles. How? Okay, it's very simple. You have somewhere also Avogadro and whatever. Fine. So the current integrator is necessary not to determine the cross-section, but to know your absolute number of incoming particles. This number you can use in many cases, for many, many purposes. Okay? Fine. So let's here be that the target A is in rest, as usually. This is what we understand in everyday nuclear physics life. And we have a particle A that is on move, okay? And the B is the heavy product, and the B capital the heavy product, and B the light product. So we forget the B capital because we said we are usually, you know, try to detect the light one. And we have here an angle theta, okay? Where we count the product. Now, in your hand, please, for the following discussion, forget the detector and think that theta is the emission angle, okay? Which means if I had the detector here, I should have a different angle. But in this case, for simplicity, forget the detector and let's have theta. Is the emission angle of the particle, okay? Some particle. So we know that we have a laboratory system and a center of mass system. In the laboratory system is the picture we understand. The small a goes to capital A, okay? This is before the event, so to say, and then you have different particles, okay, emitted in different angles. And I say again, this is the emission angle of the B, that in that case is this, okay? Whereas in the center of mass system, things are different. Both are moving and both are flying. And when they fly away, they have a difference of angle by P, okay? And if you want now to transform the energy of the projectile into the center of mass system, can you have a projectile energy in center of mass system? Is it particle specified? No. It's center of mass. Okay? Which means in many experiments when you do, even for analysis, even for, I don't know, basic research, sometimes you have to understand how you transform this energy. And this is simple. Okay? And if you don't remember the atomic mass units for the target, you just take the mass number. Okay? It's within 5% accurate. Okay. Now, products. I don't want to go into calculations now, but this is the formula that you take at the end that tells you that the square root of the flying product is given by this equation. You can find this in every textbook. So you can do that also for the heavier product by permuting the symbols B and B, B small and B capital, okay, and replacing theta with phi. What is phi? Is the emission angle of the heavy product. Okay? And for our discussion, what is below the, what is within the brackets here, let's say this is quantity C, okay? Now, let's take the case where we have an endothermic reaction. What do we observe in this case? We observe that there is a threshold energy, where is this coming from? The threshold energy. Why I get a threshold energy here? Compare this with the C. Okay? There must be some condition in my formula that give me an energy threshold. Okay? Anyway, when I have a threshold and my beam energy is below the threshold, whatever you do, you don't have a reaction. Okay? Now, when I achieve the threshold energy, what does my particle be? It goes direction theta equals zero, okay? It flies like this. But when you increase the energy, then the B particles can be within a cone, okay? Can be emitted in a cone. And the maximum angle can be what? It's given by double theta max equals 180, which means 90. Now, this formula up there has two possible solutions. Okay? You see, plus minus. Which means they can be, these solutions can be only acceptable if this term here, okay, MB plus, is smaller than zero, so that it makes sense to have the product, okay? A result. So from that condition, I take this relationship that tells me that the incident beam energy can go up to a maximum energy, and this is given by this formula. Okay? So, if this is the case, when the energy of the projectile is between the threshold energy and the maximum energy given by this condition, then you can have two groups of particles, okay, observed at the same angle, at the emission angle theta, okay, and this theta max is given by this relationship. We will come to an example, so just try to follow a bit the logic. So, let's take the case where we have, and in the case of exothermic, the energy of the flying particle is simple. It depends on the angle, and it's single-valued. So it decreases when the emission angle is increasing. Okay? You understand this, why? Okay? The bigger the angle, okay, the less the energy of the emitting particle, of the emitted particle. So let's take the first case where we have exothermic. The mass of the incoming projectile is smaller than the heavier product, okay? Or we have an exothermic, sorry, it's the other way around. Or here is wrong, okay, it's this one. Or the energy of the incoming particle is smaller, as expected, than the larger energy, the maximum energy. Then we have this picture. The emitted particles can go all over the volume, okay? But most of them, they go like this. And then their number to the other angles is decreasing. In any case, this means I have what? An angular distribution, okay? In the other case, in the reverse case, what happens? In this case, I will kill myself. The emitted particles are in the forward direction, and you can see at almost the same angle, two groups with different energies. Okay? So, exercise. Which is the Q value of the lithium? P-N reaction. Okay? What do you do that? I can give you this exercise for tomorrow. It would be nice to do it. Okay? You don't need to anything, almost nothing. You just need to follow this, what we said. And you just need only the mass excess of what was not in the list. Okay, but you can find this. Okay? Has the reaction a threshold? If you follow the formulas, you will get it. If yes, what is the threshold energy? Believe me, it's a nice exercise, very simple. Okay? What is the maximum of the reaction energy? If the proton beam energy is 1.9 MeV, which directions will the emitted neutrons take? It's all applications of what we said. Anyway. And in the second exercise, there is elastic scattering of alpha particles. To solve this exercise, what do you need to consider? Q equals zero. Okay? Okay. When do we have to go for lunch today, 12:30 or what? Okay, let's go coffee break. Let's go, no, I mean, we are, the coffee break is normally at
11.
Okay, let's go coffee break. Let's go coffee break.